to welcome you all to Jesus the Living Word Ministries. I am Minister Nelly, and I serve in this house, and it is a privilege to serve in this house. Hallelujah. I welcome you today, and for some, we may say Happy Easter. Growing up, that's what I thought it was, Easter bunnies and eggs. But it's so much more than that. And as I've gotten older, I've realized who God is and what Jesus did. And this day is Resurrection Sunday. Happy doesn't go in front of it, but this is Resurrection Sunday, and we acknowledge who He is. We honor Him for who He is today and every day. We honor You, Lord God, and I pray in this moment and today, Lord God, that everything that happens in this place, may it lift You high. May all glory go to You, Lord God. May You be honored in this place, Lord God. May we respect this place that we call Yours, Lord God. May we lift Your name on high today, Lord God. I pray for the ones that are here, Lord God. On this high Sunday, I pray for the ones that are on their way, Lord God. May they arrive here safely, Lord God. May You be with them, Lord God. And whatever may be taking them away from coming today, Lord God, I pray that You take those distractions away, Lord, and that those people come to the house to give glory to who You are, Lord God. Hallelujah. We praise You, Lord God. We come today, Lord God, with hearts ready to be filled with Your word, Lord God. We lift Your name, Lord God, on high, Lord God. And we acknowledge that today You were raised to life, Lord God. You were crucified, but You were raised to life, Lord God. And I want to go to a passage of Scripture. If you guys would like to go to 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 17. And we can read the Word of God together. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. But if we hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. Lord God, today we know that You were raised to the dead, Lord God. Because of You, Lord God, we know what sacrifice is. Because You paid that ultimate sacrifice on that cross, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, because of You, we know what true love is, Lord God. Because of You, we can have hope, Lord God. Because of You, Lord, we don't have to fear death no more, Lord. Because of You, we can have a relationship for what You did on that cross. Now we can be here today and we can have a relationship with You. We can feel Your presence in this place, Lord God. And we pray, Lord God, that Your presence meets us in this place today, Lord God. And every person here feels Your presence, Lord God, like never before, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, we welcome it here, Lord God. We want to lift You on high, Lord God, today. Lord, people came here today one way, but we know that they're going to leave here changed, Lord. We came and we know that You died for our sins. So today we humbly come before You, Lord God. We ask for forgiveness for our sins and what we have done to offend You, Lord God. We ask for forgiveness. People of God, that's important. Put pride aside and come to the Lord and ask for forgiveness. Hallelujah. He died for you and He died for me. And that's something that we can't take for granted. We must acknowledge who He is. We must acknowledge what He did for us, Lord God. We thank You for the blessings in our lives, Lord God. But we know that we are not supposed to love those blessings more than the blesser. So we let You know today, Lord God, that we love You, Lord. We love You with all of our heart, Lord God, with all of our soul, Lord God, with all of our minds, Lord God. We love You, Lord God. We thank You for Your unconditional love, Lord God, that You continue to love us, Lord God, no matter what the circumstances are, no matter how we feel, Lord God, You continue to love us. You continue to be there for us, Lord God. We have a relationship with You, Lord. We can call You Father. We can call you our loving Father. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Keep thanking him. Thanking him for the blessings that you have. Thanking him for the good, the bad, and the ugly, Lord God. We know that you have a purpose for our lives, Lord God. We know that you have a plan, Lord God. We will continue to walk in your footsteps, Lord God. We will continue to do your work, Lord God, here on earth, Lord God, until you come back, Lord. Hallelujah. We will continue to spread your word to those who need to hear it. We know that it is not just for us. There is a million people, billion people out there that need to know who you are, Lord God. Continue to help us, Lord God, to be bold in our faith, Lord God, to be courageous, hallelujah. Let us not be led by fear, hallelujah. The Lord did not give us a spirit of fear, hallelujah. And because of that, we can proclaim your good news, hallelujah. I'm here to let you know that this is good news, hallelujah. Oh, we love you, Lord. We praise you, Lord God. I pray for restoration to happen today, Lord God. Restoration in homes, Lord God, in relationships, Lord God. I pray that your will be done, Lord God, in our lives today. I pray that as families gather today, that your presence will be with them. Hallelujah. I pray for peace to be with us today. Hallelujah. Peace in our hearts and peace in our minds. Hallelujah. I pray, Lord God, that you reveal yourself to who needs to know you, Lord God. Speak to the hearts of your people, Lord God. Take away all doubt, Lord God. Oh, let them know who you are, that you are a good God. There is no one like you, Lord. You are King of Kings, hallelujah. Lord of Lords, hallelujah. You are God Almighty, and there is no one like you, Lord. You are Alpha and Omega, hallelujah. Oh, we praise you, Lord. We praise your holy name, hallelujah. We pray that we can be more like you, that we can die to self and be more like you, Jesus. Oh, Lord God, seek us. Seek us. See what's in us that you are is not of you, Lord God, and take it from us. Hallelujah. Let us be filled with your word. Let us be filled with your love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray today that faith is increased, that the blind, that people that are blind can see now who you are and what you do in our lives, Lord God, that there is no coincidence that they are here today, that you work all things out. There's no mistakes. Lord, you know what you want for your people today. Hallelujah. I pray, Lord God, that you continue to work in us, Lord God, and let us be filled today by you, Lord God. We love you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. And we know that there is no one like you. Hallelujah. We're going to have this worship team come up, and we are going to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And we are going to praise him and come together as one and be one with God. And we will worship and praise the good God that we serve. Hallelujah. I would welcome the worship team.
Hallelujah. Let us continue to thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Because he is here. I said, let us continue to thank him because he is here. Hallelujah. Our God is here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For your presence is already in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. For you rose. Hallelujah. You rose from that grave. Hallelujah. Death could not hold you, Lord. I said, death could not hold you. We do not serve a God that is dead, but the one true living God. And his name is Yeshua. His name is Yeshua. His name, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I rejoice knowing that you are my God. you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For even in the trial, I thank you, hallelujah. Because you are there with me, Lord, holding my hand, walking me through that valley, hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. Because you give life and life abundantly, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for you leave the 99 for the one that is lost, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. None like you, Lord, worthy, worthy of it all, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, hallelujah. For you meet with us day after day, week after week, Lord, with something new, hallelujah. With something new, Jesus. Always rejuvenating us with something new, hallelujah. Always filling us up with your presence, God. Thank you, Jesus. For in your house there is joy, hallelujah. In your house there is freedom, hallelujah. In your house there is miracles, hallelujah. In your house there is no more disease, no more addiction, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. None like you, Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. None like you, hallelujah. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Worthy of it all, Father, of all praise and all honor, Jesus. Let us lift our voices to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, hallelujah. Let us lift our voices, hallelujah, for he is worthy. House of the Lord today,
and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. Opened the prison doors, he parted the raging seas. My God still holds the victory. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. and surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
We sing to the God who heals.
We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling souls away. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Beggars, now we're royalty. We were the priests. forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout.
Yes, God.
We shout out your praise.
There is joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet.
We shout out your praise.
Hallelujah. How can I keep quiet, Lord, if you are already here? Hallelujah. My mouth, even if I don't want to, keeps crying out to you, Lord. Even if I don't want to, I cry out because you are here. Hallelujah. You are already here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There is joy in this place because our God has descended. Hallelujah. Our God. I said, our God. Our God. Our God. Oh, hallelujah. Our God is in this place. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for you're already in this place. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus, for in the midst of our worship. Hallelujah. I saw that faith being restored. Hallelujah. I saw those chains being broken. Hallelujah. I saw that healing. I saw that healing, Jesus. I saw that addiction being no more, God. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Because I know there is still more, God. I know there is still more, Jesus. Come on, keep worshiping. Hallelujah. For there is still more that the Lord wants to pour out. Hallelujah. Come on, people of God, keep worshiping. Keep worshiping. Keep worshiping. For our God came down. Our God came down to hear your voice, to hear you cry out, to hear you cry out. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. I don't think you understand. I said our God is here. Our God is here. Yes, God. Yes, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God, hear the cry of your people, Lord. Worthy of it all, Jesus. Don't let your worship die down. Keep on praising. Keep on praising. Hallelujah. because your worship does not depend on the music. Your worship does not depend on the song, but rather your heart, hallelujah, which is given to the Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, what a presence I feel, hallelujah. Oh, people of God, if only you knew that this is the same presence, hallelujah, where the people of Israel would travel miles just to feel, would travel miles just to feel. And here we have it day after day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. None like you, Lord. Truly, I stand amazed because I still don't know how great you are, Lord. You continue to break my expectations day after day, Jesus. Hallelujah. People of God, let us forget about everything. Hallelujah. The problems you have at home, forget about it all. The brother, the sister next to you, forget and just get intimate with the Lord. Hallelujah. For the Lord is here, hallelujah. And the time is now. The time is now, hallelujah, to connect with the Father. He came down to pour blessings, hallelujah. But only if you connect with our Father. Only if you connect with our God, hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. None like you, Lord, worthy, worthy. None like you, Lord, worthy, worthy. Is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me. Is our God, and all will see how great is our God. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. And trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice.
See how great is our God.
hearts will sing.
How great is our God.
How great.
How great is our God. Sing with me.
As the Israelites, hallelujah, as they were going to the promised land, they saw a wall in between them, hallelujah. And as they were starting to lose hope, the Lord said, walk around these walls and worship me. And as you worship me, I, the Lord, will make the walls fall down. And what the Lord wants to me, what the Lord wants me to tell you, hallelujah, walk around those walls, worship me, and allow me to take care of it. I, the Lord will take care of it. Worship me, worship me, worship me, worship me, for I am the same God that took Israel out of Egypt. Worship me, worship me. Oh Jesus, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, oh Jesus.
How great I am, says the Lord. If only you knew how great I am. For I am the I am, hallelujah. If only you knew how great I am, you wouldn't be doubting me, hallelujah. If only you knew, people of God, how great he was. Hallelujah. Like you, Lord. Presence I feel, my God. Oh, what a tangible presence I feel. Oh, what more needs to be said, people of God? The Lord has already spoken, hallelujah. The Lord has already spoken, and here he is. Here he is, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. What a tangible presence I feel, God. A presence where my legs feel weak, hallelujah. Where I can barely stand, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, people of God, the time is now. If you are seeking something, bow down and worship Him. Hallelujah. Because the Lord our God is here. The time is now. Take advantage of this presence. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus.
Arise.
Hallelujah. You are worthy of it all. Hallelujah. Yes, God. The Lord is saying right now, tell them, son, that what I am doing right now is an outpouring of my Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. What I am doing right now, hallelujah, is pouring out my Holy Spirit like a mighty fire, like a mighty wind. Hallelujah. Tell them, son, that my Holy Spirit is going to fall upon them right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. None like you, Lord. You deserve the glory. Hallelujah.
He loves us so much. So we really need to sit here and think, is he worthy of it all? What is he worthy of? Hallelujah. Our time, our praise, our prayers, Lord, you are worthy of it all. The sacrifices that we must make, you are worthy, Lord God. Let us know what we need to lay down, Lord God, before you, Lord God. So we can confirm. We can praise you in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. So we can see things for what they are. We lift you up, Lord God. Today we recognize who you are and what you did for us today, Lord God. And we love you, Lord. And I don't know about you, but if you haven't invited him into your heart, invite him. He's a loving father. Hallelujah. When this happens, when they worship here, it's not music, it's not entertainment. We are worshiping the one true God. That is serious, people of God. The one true God. We are lifting up praises to heaven. Hallelujah. We are asking for his presence to be with us. His love to be felt. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, you are worthy of it all. No matter what our circumstances are, whatever we face, however we felt today, coming here, let it go. Let it go. Stop worrying about situations and people. God works things out. He has a plan. And today we can acknowledge that he has fulfilled his plan. Hallelujah. Because of you, Lord God, we have life and life abundantly. Hallelujah. Because of you, Lord God, we have hope. Not wishful thinking. We have hope. Because of you, Lord, we can have peace. A peace that surpasses all understanding. Sometimes we can't even understand the presence of God. We don't even know how powerful it is. That's why when we come here and worship, You can close your eyes, lift up your hands. Don't worry about anybody. Hallelujah. If you need to lift up a prayer during that time, do it. It's with you and God. It's not with you and the worship team. Get lost in His presence. I don't know about you, but I can't sit in His presence. When this music is playing, when we are worshiping, I must stand and I must give Him my all. Hallelujah, because He is worthy. Worthy you are, Lord. Worthy is the Lamb. Hallelujah. And today, we acknowledge that you are brought back to life. This is Resurrection Sunday. And we know that it also goes with Passover, which, if you know the calendar, God's calendar, that will be celebrated in April. Pastor will be bringing that. But today we acknowledge Him, for He died and He resurrected. And with that comes hope in life. We no longer have to fear death. We have a God. We have a home that we're all going to. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. And we're going to continue to worship, and we're going to continue to honor Him with our tithes and our offerings. If I can have the ushers come forward. And as they were up here saying, from you are all things, and to you are all things, it just stuck out to me. And I feel like I need to emphasize on that as we prepare for our tithes. He is the giver. He is the taker. From all things, He has provided us with all things. Not everything that we want, we get, but He fulfills our needs. And sometimes what we need is greater than what we can even think. Hallelujah. So today, we are going to give what you deserve, Lord God, because we know you are worthy of it all. Hallelujah. We prepare, and I want to pray over them, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that as we prepare to give back to you what you deserve, Lord God, I pray the hands that are giving it to you, Lord God. I pray over their finances, Lord God, the ones that are able to give, Lord God. May you bless them, Lord God. And for the ones that are not able to, Lord God, you know their heart and you know their circumstances, and you already have a plan figured out for them, Lord God. And it will be fulfilled in the name of Jesus. So today we give you with grateful hearts. And the ushers may go forward. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. And I would just like to give a couple of announcements. We are working on our new temple. Hallelujah. It's hard work, but with all of our hands, we can get it done. Hallelujah. I can't wait to be in there. Hallelujah. Praise God. And with all of you, we can make that happen. And everyone here, I mean, I even have my children, and the youth were there. I was so happy to see them there. They're there from 9:30 to 4 every day, Monday through Saturday. So all is welcome to give a hand. I know we got some handymen and women, because us women have been there as well. Hallelujah. So let's continue to do that work in our new temple. I also have another, I didn't even say the ways of giving. Oh my God. We did the tithes and offerings. If you were here and you seen an envelope, I know that you gave in an envelope. And if you weren't, and if you still have money to give and you would like to give by text, it was 84321. So sorry, I go ahead of myself sometimes. Hallelujah. And you can also give online to www.jesusthelivingword.org for the ones that don't carry cash and couldn't give here today. And we know that it goes to the Lord. Thank you, Lord. The other announcement is we will be having our women's service again the second Friday of April. And I believe it's the 12th. Hallelujah. We're bringing it back. And we are here for prayer. Prayer is so important. And if you aren't here, we hope that you are praying in your homes. And anywhere you are, hallelujah, because we need to pray for our new temple. We need to pray for ourselves. We need to pray for others. We need to pray for our pastor and all the pastors and people that serve in our house, because you need to cover them in prayer. Hallelujah. Don't underestimate the power of prayer. So I'm asking you, if you come, take advantage of the days that we are here. And if you can't, get on your knees and however you pray, and let's cover each other in prayer always, because we live in a broken world. We have so much going on, but the Lord wants to hear from us, and it's very important. Amen. With that being said, I would like to welcome our pastor, Kobe Hernandez. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God bless you, church. You know I'm going to try one more time, right? God bless you, church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Will you take a moment and turn to the person next to you and tell them, I'm so happy that you are in the house of the Lord. Now, but you got to do it with a smile. Come on. Tell the neighbor next to you, I'm so happy that you're in the house of the Lord. Glory to God. Welcome to Jesus, the Living Word Ministries. Hallelujah. This is a place where we operate on the open heavens. If you do not know what that means, it's very simple. From this house, the Lord does miracles, signs, and wonders. And if you believe it, you say amen and amen. Let me take a moment and dismiss our children now to their class. If this is your first time and you have children, we do ask you to step outside for a few minutes. Our teachers have some questions to ask you to better serve your children today in the house of the Lord. And while the children are going to the class, please allow me to say welcome to any new visitors that are here in the house of the Lord. Will you put your hands together for the visitors today? We are honored to have you here. We also welcome those that are watching online via YouTube, Facebook. Thank you for spending your Sunday with us. The church says amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I have one announcement before I preach today's message. And I'm going to echo what Minister Nelly said to us. The importance of prayer. Everybody say prayer.
Prayer.
Prayer is not optional for believers. If you're not a Christian, it's okay if you feel like it or don't feel like it. But prayer is not optional for a believer. For how will you speak with your Heavenly Father if we don't pray? This is why we want to remind you that on the third Friday of every month, we have a prayer vigil in this house at 10 p.m. Somebody says amen.
Amen.
Lift up your hands if you want to come. If you want to come. The Lord already saw your hands. Glory to God. So I hope that you can make it to this time of prayer. This is in addition to our daily prayer at 7 p.m. in this house, Monday through Friday. And you might say, why do we pray that much? Because the Bible says, pray at all times, with all kinds of prayer in all seasons. Hallelujah. So if the Bible calls us to pray, we are going to pray together. Amen? Amen? Amen. I think only Sister Maria likes prayer. Amen. We all going to pray. And in the continent of Africa, there is a saying. It says, if there is a people that prays, there is a God who answers. Hallelujah. If we don't pray, he cannot answer. But if we do pray, glory to God, he will answer our prayers. Somebody says amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now, today I'm going to preach a message, and I have to be very honest with you. My message is not an Easter message. It's not at all. And the reason why it's not an Easter message is because the Bible doesn't have an Easter message. Somebody says amen. So I cannot preach to you an Easter message where the Bible doesn't talk about Easter. Hallelujah. And if you are a little confused, just give me 10 minutes, and I clarify to you through the scripture what I mean by that statement. Hallelujah. But one thing I would do today is I would preach the word of God to you. Somebody says amen.
Amen.
And I understand that perhaps there are many people who come to church on a day like today. Nothing wrong if you are coming because it's a day that perhaps you think, yes, we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord. And I hope and pray that that is the reason why many churches today are receiving many visitors, that people are coming to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody says amen.
Amen.
But I have to tell you, I'm very obedient to the Lord, and I only speak to you while he speaks to me. I don't have the choice to change messages. I gave that long time ago. I said, I speak while you speak. And this is why, even though the temptation is very strong in this season to preach an Easter sermon, I chose to obey the Lord. Somebody says amen. And I guarantee that the word that you're going to hear today will bless your life. If you believe it, you say amen. Amen. Now, my message today, and I want to tell you this very plainly, it's not going to be a message trying to explain to you what's going to happen on April 8th. How many of you have heard April 8th? There's an eclipse that is coming up. I'm not going to talk to you about that. In fact, you should not be surprised of any of that. It was written 2,000 years ago that you will see things like this, and those are the signs. Somebody says amen. So I'm not preaching about that. And the reason why I'm telling you this is because I will touch a subject within today's message that it might look like if I am talking about that, but I'm not talking about that. Somebody says amen. You have to understand, this generation is putting so much pressure in the preachers today that the preachers now have to preach what, by popularity people wants to hear. Well, I am so sad to disappoint you. I'm not a popular preacher. Hallelujah. My job is to preach the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. And the day I preach something different, then that is the day where the anointing is going to leave. And I love the anointing of the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody says amen. So today I'm going to speak about the sign of Jesus. Come on, say with me, the sign of Jesus. And we're going to see through the scripture what that means today and what is the message of Christ to the church today about the sign of Jesus. With that, I'm going to ask you to stand on your feet if you may. I want to read scripture in the book of Matthew chapter 12. You are free to follow in your own Bibles if you have your Bibles with you. But in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, beginning on verse 38, this is the word of the Lord. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, meaning Jesus, "Teacher, we want to see a sign from you." But he answered and said to them, "An evil and adulterous generation craves a sign. And so no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah the prophet." Verse 40. "For just as Jonah was in the stomach of the sea monster for 3 days and three nights, so will the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights. The men of Nineveh will stand out with this generation at judgment and will condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here." Would you read that verse 41 with me again, please? "The men of Nineveh will stand out with this generation at the judgment and will condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here." Verse 42. "The queen of the south will rise up with this generation at judgment and will condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And behold, something greater than Solomon, it's here." Will you bow your head for a word of prayer? Father, I thank you because your word is already blessed and your word is already anointed. And I thank you because your word cannot return to you void, but it must accomplish the purpose for which you sent it forth. So I am praying, Holy Spirit, that you will help us, that you will prepare our hearts and minds to allow your word to do what your word does best, and that is to bring transformation to the hearts and lives in Jesus' name. And you say amen. Amen. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. The passage that you just read out of the book of Matthew is repeated throughout the Gospels, and we will see this today, especially when we get to the Gospel of Luke. Luke is going to give us details to fully understand what is it that Jesus was telling his disciple, his audience. What was it that Jesus was responding to then? And we're going to see that in a moment. But let me break down this for you before I get into the message itself. I want to define a few words for you so that we can understand this passage in two ways. Number one, in the way that God meant it to say it, and you say amen. It is not the same thing what I think about the word and what God says the word says. Hallelujah. So I'm going to define a few terms so that you and I can understand this passage in the way God meant it, but also like the audience who heard this message understood what Jesus was saying. And let me begin with the word sign. Now, the word sign in the Bible is very popular, both in the Old and in the New Testament. And it all depends on the context to determine what it really means. The reason why I say this is because when you think about the word sign in the New Testament, can it speak about a heavenly event on the sky? And I know heavenly in the sky, you might be thinking it's the same thing. No. What I'm saying is it's something from God, from the heavenly realm on the sky that is visible. That it speaks of a sign. And we have Bible passages that will tell you that this is one definition of the word sign. For instance, in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 14, read it with me. What does it say? They shall serve as sign. From the beginning of the Bible, God has told you and I that he is going to use the moon, the stars, and the sun, not only to give us light, but also to be a sign, to send us a message. So we should not be surprised about things like what we hear today. There's an eclipse coming. Yes, God already said in Genesis chapter 1 that he's going to use this as signs. Everybody say sign. Now, in the Gospel of Luke chapter 21, specifically on verse 11, this is why you see that a sign can be something displayed on the sky that comes from God Almighty. Because he says, and there will be massive earthquakes, and in various places plagues and famines, and there will be terrible sights and great signs from heaven. Those are visible things. But the signs of heaven are not pointing to the sign, but are pointing to somebody else. And we are going to see this in a moment. Signs that comes from God always point to God. Somebody says amen. Will you read that statement with me? Sign pointing to God. If you want to determine if something comes from the Lord, you just need to know what is the final outcome. Is it leading people to God or is it leading people somewhere else? Hallelujah. Every sign that God displays, whether it's on the sky, whether it's on the earth, wherever he does it, if it's a sign from God, always seeking to lead people to the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So now that we have one of the definitions of the word sign, I want to speak about a heavenly sign and the prophet Jonah. We just read in Matthew that Jesus refers to the sign of Jonah. And we are going to understand what does that mean. Now, I'm going to tell you, and this is the point that I'm going to be touching, and it might sound like I'm talking about the upcoming eclipse, but I'm not talking about it. Somebody says amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me say one more time. I'm not talking about it. Hallelujah. I'm giving you scriptures so that you know how to filter what's happening around you through the lenses of the Bible. The heavenly sign and Jonah. Historically, you can even Google this. There was such a thing as an eclipse in the year 763 before Christ. Yes, historically, you can find that. Now, this date is important because this date is closely around the time of Jonah the prophet. Say with me, Jonah. It's about the same time. But the Bible never says that in the time of Jonah, when he preached to Nineveh, that there was an eclipse. That is a speculation. So you have to be very careful. When the Bible is silent, you must be silent. Somebody says amen. Because if we begin to read into the Bible, we are going to force the Bible to say something that the Bible never said. And I want you to understand this very carefully today. You cannot force the scripture to prove your own personal point. Hallelujah. And there are many preachers today that they have an idea, and they are more faithful to their idea than what the Bible says. They will do whatever they can do to make the scripture support one personal opinion, but we cannot do that. Somebody says amen. So it is true, there was an eclipse on 763 right around the time of Jonah. Now, the book of Amos, the prophet Amos was around the time of Jonah too. And in the book of Amos 5:8 and chapter 8, verse 8 through 11, it speaks of what could be an eclipse sent by God. But Amos never point to the time of Jonah to say, when Jonah preached in Nineveh, there was an eclipse, and that is the reason why people repented. And I will talk about that in a moment. You need to understand this, people of God. There is a difference between remorse and repentance. Somebody say amen. You have to understand this. If people are waiting for a calamity to know Jesus, let me tell you, they might be feeling remorse, and years later they will walk away. Somebody says amen. Let me prove this to you with an event that touches all. I'm talking about 9/11. Churches were flooded with people, but people left churches years later. Hallelujah. Because there is a difference between feeling remorse and feeling repentance. Hallelujah. So it's important to understand this. Now, Amos is going to say something very powerful. He's going to say that whether this is an eclipse or not, he's going to say something is going to happen afterward. And one of the things that he speaks of a famine. But I want you to know, this is why you must go back to the text. Because the famine that the prophet Amos is referring to is not a lack of food, it's not a lack of water. He says there will be a lack of the word of God among the people. Hallelujah. Aren't we living in those times today? Hallelujah. That people don't want to hear the word of God anymore. That people rather hear something else but not the word of God. This is exactly what the prophet Amos, who ministered around the time of Jonah, is referring about. Somebody says amen. Now turn to the person next to you and tell them, the pastor's going somewhere. Just wait a moment. Come on, turn. Tell him, just wait a moment. He's going somewhere. Hallelujah. I'm giving you, let me tell you this. I do nothing to preach to you something that you don't understand. So I must build the foundation so I can say exactly what I want to say. Hallelujah. Now, hear me now for a moment. We talked about a sign. We talked about a heavenly sign in connection to Jonah. But now let's talk about a sign as a confirming miracle. Say with me, miracles. God will often do signs or miracles to point to the reality that there is a God, that God is alive, and he is willing to work through you and around you. Somebody says amen. This is why he does a miracle. In fact, in the book of John, in the chapter 2 and verse 11, read this verse with me, please. It says, this beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and revealed his glory. And what does it say? And his disciples did what? So the sign was pointing to the one that they needed to believe in. So the signs that comes from God, let me give you a second characteristic of a sign that comes from God, is that it will awaken in you faith in the Lord God. Hallelujah. It will not point you to a different direction, but it will point you to the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, signs are supernatural works from God pointing to whom? Let's do it again. They are supernatural works from God pointing to whom? I want you to understand, if a sign is pointing you to me, then you have to do a little judging. Hallelujah. But if a sign is pointing you to God, then pay attention to the Lord, because the Lord is speaking to you. Hallelujah. I want you to understand, my generation is packed with people that are pointing people to people. Hallelujah. And God is saying, my signs do not point people to people, but point people to God. Hallelujah. And this is where we need to have our emphasis. Where is the sign leading us? Is it leading us to a platform where I'm going to get 100,000 views and my name will be known, or is it leading us to the person of Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. Now hear me for a moment. Signs are supernatural works from God pointing to God. Now, Jesus now speaks of the sign of Jonah. I want you, when you read the scriptures, you have to pay attention to what exactly God says. Because Jesus is going to say, remember, there is a people that is asking for a sign. And Jesus said, I'm not going to give you a sign except one. And he speaks of the sign of Jonah. Let's talk about for a moment. Listen to what Luke chapter 11 is speaking about the same account. Let me tell you, whenever you're reading the Synoptic Gospels, those are Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and you want to know the details about something that happened in the Gospel, go read the Gospel of Luke. Because Luke is going to take the time to explain things that the other Gospels don't do. Why? Because Luke is writing from an investigating point of view, and he's going to give you details that are essential. Why do I say this? Because in Matthew, we read at the beginning of this message that the people were asking for a sign, and Jesus said, I will only give you the sign of Jonah. But now listen to Luke as speaking of the same account. Come on, let's read it together. What does it say? For just as Jonah became a sign to the Ninevites, so will the Son of Man be to this generation. Hallelujah. Who became a sign? Jonah himself. So now, because you know what exactly Jesus meant when you just read the Gospel of Luke, you will avoid putting your emphasis, your mind into the other things that might come as a result of that, because now Jesus is telling you exactly what is the sign that he's referring to. Why am I saying this? Because when I read Jesus within this context, Jesus is not telling you to pay attention to the eclipse. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I know I broke some of you theology that was formed in the last 3 weeks. Hallelujah. I know you probably bought the books about it. You have research about it and you formed your theology. Jesus is telling you that the sign that he's speaking about is not the eclipse. It's not the famine. It's not the earthquake. He's telling you, as Jonah became a sign, so will the Son of Man be. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It's important to read the scripture for what the scripture actually says. This is key here. Why this passage is key to understand what Jesus is saying? Because the sign of Jonah is not an eclipse. And I'm not saying that an eclipse did not happen when Jonah preached in Nineveh. But what I'm telling you is that the Bible doesn't say that when he preached in Nineveh, there was an eclipse. In fact, you might find preachers today that said the reason why people repented was because they saw an eclipse. No, no, no. If they repented because of this, that's not repentance. No, no, no. Repentance only comes when God himself works in the heart of a man. Hallelujah. This is when men repent. Hallelujah. Otherwise, around the world, we will only have believers. You know how many calamity happens every year? In fact, in Baltimore, everybody should be serving God today because there were people who died out of that accident. In New York, everybody should be a believer because 9/11 destroys so many people's lives. I want you to understand, repentance only comes through the person of God himself. Only he can minister to the heart so the heart can say, yes, Jesus. Somebody says amen. So the sign of Jonah is not the eclipse. The sign of Jonah is not the calamity. But Jonah himself was a sign pointing to who? I love it. Hallelujah. Because the sign of God always points to God. Hallelujah. And this is why Jesus says very openly, you are asking for a sign, but I'm not going to do it. The only sign I'm going to give you is the sign of Jonah. And then he defines what that is. Jonah became a sign to the Ninevites, so the Son of Man will be in this generation. Amen. Now, I'm about to tell you what I really want to tell you now. And it's this. Let's compare Jonah and Jesus. Because if Jonah is the sign, became a sign pointing to Jesus, let's see what is it that Jonah did that reflected or spoke about the coming of Jesus Christ. Because if this is a sign that he's using to speak about his ministry, then there's something about Jonah that we need to learn today. Number one, Jonah was what? Come on, say it with me. Help me preach. He was what? He was a prophet. Number two, Jonah was what? Come on, number three, Jonah was? Number four, Jonah was what? I want you to understand Jonah's ministry. Yes, he was a prophet of the living God. He was one that was sent by God, no doubt about it. In fact, Jonah was so called by God that when he refused to do the will of God, God forced him to go back and do the will of God. Hallelujah. That's how called of God Jonah was. But nevertheless, hear me now. Jonah was a man. Hallelujah. Now, Jonah was sent by God to save, to preserve Nineveh. Now, let's compare this with the person of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is saying, the sign of Jonah, I will give you. The symbolism of Jonah, I'm about to give you. Now, who was Jesus? Jesus was not just a prophet. He was the great prophet. Somebody says amen. There's no other prophet like Jesus. In the book of Numbers, God said to Moses, Moses, I want you to know I'm going to raise a prophet among you. Not like you. He's greater than you. He will have the power and authority. Hallelujah. And he's referring to the prophetic ministry of Messiah Jesus. Number two, read it with me. Jesus was what? Sent? Sent by who? Sent by who? I wrote this intentional. Notice how I said Jonah was sent by God, but Jesus was sent by the Father. I did that intentional because there's a big difference between Jonah and Jesus in this sense. I want you to know, in the Old Testament, I don't want to say none, but close to nobody knew God as a father. Close to no one knew God as the Father. In fact, there are instances in the history of Israel that the nation has the gleams and begin to think about God as the Father of the nation. But there was no one personally who could say, God is my Father. This is the reason why they wanted to kill Jesus. Because Jesus showed up and says, oh, my Father sent me. Who's your Father? My Heavenly Father. And then when Jesus begins to say this, people are in shock because they were not used to hear a man saying that God was his Father. And this is why I put it right here. Jesus was sent by the Father. Number three, read it with me. Jesus was what? I love it. Hallelujah. Never confuse Jonah with Jesus. Jonah was just a sign, a symbol, but Jesus was God himself. Hallelujah. Jonah was pointing to somebody else. Hallelujah. And Jesus came as God himself. Somebody says amen. And read the last one. Jesus was what? I want you to understand this for a moment. I want you, and I apologize for the typo here, but I want you to hear this for a moment. Jonah was sent to Nineveh. Jesus was sent for the world. Hallelujah. There's a different magnitude of the ministry of Jonah versus Jesus. While Jonah was just to the Ninevite, now Jesus is not only to the Ninevite. He's not only to the Hispanics. He's not only to the Americans. Hallelujah. He's not only to the Africans, not only to the Asians, but Jesus was sent for the world. Hallelujah. That is the ministry of Messiah. Glory to God. And the difference between Jesus and Jonah is this. Jonah was willing to disobey. Jesus submitted to the will of the Father. Hallelujah. I want you to understand, if Jesus was like Jonah, he probably would have run away. Glory to God. But when he was feeling weak, he did not run away. He said, God, Father, is there any other way? And because there was no other way, he said, let it be your will. Hallelujah. I go to the cross for a people that don't even know me. I give my life for them. Somebody says amen. Yeah. Glory to God. So it's important for you to understand what Jesus is saying when he says, I'm giving you the sign of Jonah. Now turn to the person next to you and say, the pastor's coming at you now. Come on, come on. If this is not applicable to you, I'm wasting my time. If the word is not applicable to you and to me, then something is wrong. Hallelujah. Great message, but if it's not applicable to our daily life today, what are we going to do with this message? And this is where I want to spend a few minutes with you. The sign of Jonah, it speaks about Jesus' death. Come on, read it with me. Death, burial, and resurrection. Come on, let's say it again. Death, burial, and resurrection. This is what Jonah and Jesus are talking about. Jesus even said in Matthew, and we read it, just like Jonah was in the belly of a sea creature, so the Son of Man will be in the center of the earth, meaning the Son of God will die, the Son of God will be buried, but the Son of God will rise again. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want you to understand this, because this is what happened to Jonah. Now reflects what will happen, what happened to Jesus in the New Testament. Now, the important elements of the context of Matthew chapter 12, when Jesus is speaking to a crowd and he's responding, remember the crowd are saying, we want a sign, we want a sign. That crowd looks like the crowd of this generation. We want a sign, we want to see, we want to see, we want to see. Hallelujah. And Jesus is still saying, you will not see, except the sign of Jonah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, what are the elements of this context? Elements number one. Say with me, audience. Pay attention to who Jesus is saying what he's saying. Because he has an immediate audience. And the audience that Jesus speaks to, remember, in verse 38 of Matthew 12, it tells you, and the Pharisees and the scribes were demanding for a sign. Say with me, Pharisees and scribes. That is the audience that Jesus is speaking to. Now, you have to understand this. The Pharisees and the scribes, we might not like them today, but I have to tell you, they were the representative of the house of God. Somebody says amen. Whether we liked them or not, they were the one in the Sanhedrin. They were the one in the temple, the Pharisees, the scribes, and the Sadducees. Why this is important? Because you have to understand this. When God is about to correct things, he begins in the house. Amen. Hallelujah. You have to be careful saying judgment is coming, because before he hit then, God needs to correct things inside. Hallelujah. He needs to work things in us before he can judge everybody else. Somebody says amen. So the audience is the Pharisees and the scribes that Jesus is saying, I'm not going to give you a sign. No, no, no. But the sign of Jonah. Why is he saying the sign of Jonah? Think about this audience, the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees. Yet they were in the temple, but they were rebellious people against God. And what happened to Jonah when he rebelled? God, hallelujah, made a gray sea creature to swallow him. Hallelujah. And this is exactly what God is telling to his audience. But in the audience, we have a larger group. And it's this. Come on, let's read it with me. What does it say? It's a wicked generation. It says, an evil and adulterous generation. I want you to understand, when Jesus replies to the Pharisees and to the scribes, he's going to tell you, who are the people that are asking for a sign? He called them, they are evil and they are adulterous. Now, I put this into parentheses so that the church will understand this today. The world craves for a sign, not the church. Are you hearing me now? The world craves to see a sign, not the church. And here's why. Why do you want to see a sign when a sign points to Jesus, where you already know Jesus? Why do we want a sign to tell us about Jesus when we are in a relationship with Jesus? Hallelujah. it's okay for the world to crave for a sign, but the church already has the sign. Hallelujah. The church already knows the Christ that the sign is pointing to. Somebody says amen. So you have to be very careful. Church, do not let us not act like the world, but let us act like the people of God. Hallelujah. I don't need a sign. I know Jesus already. Hallelujah. I know Messiah already. I know what he did for me. I know he died for me. I know he rose from the dead. I know he forgave me. I know I'm in a relationship with you. I don't need to wait for a sign to know that, because the sign will point to the one that already revealed himself to me. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. So the church needs to know and understand this. Let us not act like a world that does not know Jesus. We know Messiah. We don't need a sign. Hallelujah. We are already people of faith. And you say amen, amen, and amen. So I don't need a sign because I already know Messiah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, something of the audience that you need to pay attention is this. Lack of repentance. Come on, say with me. Lack of repentance. I don't want you to miss what Jesus said. I will give you the sign of Jonah. But then he says, the Ninevites, they will condemn this generation. Why? Because the Ninevite repented, but this generation did not. Come on, say ouch before I say what I'm about to say. Let me tell you, God has no problem whatsoever if it is true that you and I are like Thomas that said, I need to see to believe. God said, oh, no problem. I show you so you can believe. But there are many people that have been praying this for years. I need to see to believe. And God revealed things to them, and they're still in the rebellious attitude towards God. Hallelujah. I want you to understand what I'm saying, people of God. There's a lack of repentance in the generations that Jesus is speaking about. I want you to hear this. Something different is happening from the sign of Jonah and to the generation that Jesus is speaking about. The generation of Jonah, when they heard Jonah speak to them, they repented. Somebody says amen. This generation, when they hear about God, they do not repent. And Christ is calling the church to know this. Stop pointing people to a sign. Point people towards Jesus. Hallelujah. Stop convincing people to the natural senses. Let them have faith in the heart so they will know Messiah, Jesus. Somebody says amen. So there was a lack of repentance. Nineveh repented. But this generation that Jesus speaks about did not repent. Hallelujah. This is why even in this generation, you might, let me illustrate this. This happened in real life to me. It was about 9 p.m. And a group of young people called me on the phone and said, we all want to give our life to Jesus today. Can we go to your house? They said, no, absolutely. Come, all of you. And they sat in my living room. And they all were excited to receive Jesus. And I asked them one question. Why? Why do you want Jesus? We were watching a documentary and we are afraid. I said, that's not the reason to serve Jesus. No, I cannot pray for you. You do not give your life to Jesus because you are afraid and you want to escape hell. You give your heart to him because you have faith in Jesus and you love Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And let me tell you, in this generation, even churches are so focused on getting people by fear inside, but they will never make it to the kingdom of heaven. This is why you need to be very careful. Do not get caught up in the wave of this age. Hallelujah. You already know the word. Hallelujah. You already know the Lord. Hallelujah. You should know where to point people to, and that is to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you believe it, you say amen, amen, and amen. Now hear me now for a moment. And I apologize if I am, I don't know if I'm destroying the spirit of Easter today. I'm so sorry, but I must preach the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now hear me now for a moment. The message of the sign, because there is a message. There's a message to the church. Come on, read it with me. And stop acting like a word that does not know Jesus. We got to stop acting like that. We got to stop being moved left and right by everything that comes. Hallelujah. Like if this is a surprise, let me tell you. In Matthew 24, they asked Jesus, what will be the signs of the end? And there's a whole passage. You can read it. Hallelujah. It is there written. He tells you. But when all of that is said and done, he says, nevertheless, those are just the sign, the beginning of birth pain, but that is not the end. Somebody says amen. I want you to understand what I'm preaching here today has a lot of relevancy in our day today. Why do I say the church needs to stop acting like the world? This is what I mean. The church hears something is coming, and instead of, you know, bowing on their knees, they bow to the supermarket. They bow to the bank account. Let me tell you, when something is coming, food will not preserve you. Money will not preserve you. What will preserve you is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Hallelujah. Nothing else will preserve you. Glory to God. Do not act like the world. You see those millionaires, they're building bunks, a house on the ground where they are going to be there. Let me tell you, when calamity comes, not even that will preserve people. The only thing preserving us is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Church, are you hearing what I'm saying? We are not the world. Hallelujah. We are the sons and daughters of the living God. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory. Haven't you read a scripture that in the times of calamity, God knows a way to protect their people? Hallelujah. In the times of a plague, yeah, if there's a plague that comes, let it come. You are the people of God. Hallelujah. He has a way to protect you. Glory to God. If there is a famine coming, let it come. Hallelujah. You are the son and daughters of the living God. Hallelujah. And if he did it for Israel, he can do it for you as well. Hallelujah. There's no food, no problem. I will feed my people myself. Hallelujah. I bring manna from heaven to you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So the church needs to undress from the world and go back to be the church. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So let us stop acting like if we don't know Jesus. We know Jesus. Amen. How many of you know Jesus? So if you know him, then you should know this. When the end comes, you will be fine. Hallelujah. In fact, chances are that when the end comes, you will be taken away from here. Hallelujah. And nothing will face you. Glory to God. It is in the Bible, people of God. Jesus said, wait, angels, stop. Do not harm anybody. Let me finish sealing the elect of God. Meaning, before you go, I'm going to preserve my people. You cannot touch these people. Hallelujah. Famine will not touch you. Plagues will not touch you. God is telling you, as the church, you don't worry about these things. Mm-mm. No. In fact, if you only knew your role in the midst of this, you will know that you should not be worrying about that. Because your role is this. Are you ready? Lift your hands to heaven. You are now the sign pointing to Jesus. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You are the sign pointing to Jesus. You are the one who says Jesus is alive today. Hallelujah. You are the one who says, Jesus saved my life, hallelujah, and he wants to do the same for you. The problem is that we don't understand language, but when Paul says you are an ambassador of heaven, he's saying you are a representation of what is in heaven, hallelujah. You are the sign today to this generation that Jesus is alive. Somebody says amen. So the church needs to be acting like the world. Number two, and this is to the world. And let me clarify, when I say the world, I'm talking to anybody. Say with me, anybody. And everybody who is not in a relationship with Jesus Christ. That includes people inside and outside the church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody who does not know Jesus personally is the world. I want you to understand. Now, he's only committed to his family. Hallelujah. He's only committed to his children. Now, to the world, God wants to tell the world this. Not to you, church. He should not be telling us this. No, we already know Jesus. We don't need a sign. But to the world, he's saying, there is no greater sign to see that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Hallelujah. There's nothing greater than that, people of God. Nothing absolutely greater. That the sun and the moon will collide at the same time and it will be darkness. That is not even greater, hallelujah, than the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Messiah Jesus. Hallelujah. That there will be famine. No problem, people of God. That is not greater than the death, burial, and resurrection of Messiah Jesus. There will be plagues and sickness and disease. No problem, people of God. There is no sign that is greater than the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Messiah Jesus. Somebody says amen. The church needs to tell the world this. Hallelujah. Do not put your eyes on this. Yes, this will come and more will come. But let me tell you who your attention, your faith should be on. And that is on Jesus Christ alone. Somebody says amen. This is a message to the world. The world can be deceived, but not the church. Hallelujah. And the world needs to know there is a Jesus, a resurrected Jesus Christ that is the greatest sign that humanity will ever witness. Somebody says amen. Paul even says, if Christ have not risen from the dead, our faith is in vain. Somebody says amen. Meaning our faith, the Christian faith, is founded on this. That indeed Christ rose from the dead. Hallelujah. So therefore the world needs to know this and not to go crazy about the things that are coming. Hallelujah. And it's okay. I'm not asking you to go home. If you bought the whole supermarket preparing for April 8th, just keep it. Maybe somebody else needs some food and God is going to use you to bless somebody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But what I'm telling you, people of God, is we should not put our trust on those things. Amen. Because just like in the time of Israel, whenever we do that, God is going to make sure that by the next day, it's not good anymore. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So if you do not want to waste your money buying things that God will make it perish, then do not put your trust on those things. Put your trust in the Lord God. Hallelujah. If you're going to buy water, buy it trusting in the Lord, not in that water. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, I want you to understand this. The message of the sign is this. Yes, difficult times are coming. Somebody says amen. We know this since 2,000 years ago. He told us that. Let me tell you this. The reality is this. It's going to get from worse to worse. Hallelujah. But for you, the sons and daughters, glory to God, it's going to be from glory to glory. Hallelujah. From faith to faith. From grace to grace, because you are God's people. Hallelujah. For you is like that, but for the world, oh no, it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. If you think that the pandemic was the worst thing we saw, no, it's getting worse. Somebody says amen, it's getting worse. There's no other way around it. It's gonna get worse because it is written. Hallelujah. By the God of the universe. Now, there will be famine, there will be earthquake, there will be wars, there will be pestilence. We already know that, church. Hallelujah. We know it. Glory to God. The world doesn't know it. But here's what we need to know. Read it with me like you believe it. Only who? Jesus. Only Jesus can preserve you. And he's telling his generation, he was telling his generation, I give you one sign, and it's a sign of Jonah. Just like Jonah was in the belly of a sea creature for 3 days and three nights, so the Son of Man will be in the same, it will go through the same thing. Not through the belly of a sea creature. No. He's going to die, and he's going to be buried for 3 days too. But he was telling his generation, but he will also rise again. Hallelujah. And that is our victory, people of God, that he rose from the dead And he is who he said that he was. He is the Son of God, God himself, and he's our only preservation. If you believe it, you lift your hands to heaven and say, Lord, I believe it. We depend on Jesus, people of God. Nothing else. Nothing else. We all depend on Messiah Jesus. That is the sign of Jonah. Hallelujah. Now, hear me now. When Jonah did the will of God, even though he was forced to do it. Are you hearing what I just said? Jonah was forced to do the will of God. Jonah said, I won't do it. God says, no problem. I force you to go back. Hallelujah. I'm going to make sure a sea creature swallow you, and I'm going to command the sea creature to turn around, bring you back, and spit you out, because you will do what I say. Somebody says amen. And I know in this generation, we say, we all have free will. As long as your free will does not interfere with the plan of God, he will respect that. Hallelujah. But the one who gave you free will, he has the authority to take it away as well. Now, when Jonah was forced to go back, a whole nation repented. And the Bible says they did not repent when they saw what was on the sky. No. It says when they heard Jonah. Because faith comes by what? Hallelujah. And hearing what? Hallelujah. No, hearing the news is hearing the word of God. And then there was great repentance in Nineveh, the whole nations, from the king to the babies. Hallelujah. And God is saying, if my people understand the sign of Jesus now, I am greater than Jonah. Hallelujah. I not only was in darkness for 3 days, I came out of darkness conquering death. Hallelujah. And if you speak about my name, there will be greater repentance than that of Nineveh. Hallelujah. Men and women will come to salvation when you speak about Jesus. Somebody says amen. They will not come to salvation when you speak about, oh, there's an earthquake coming. We have had many earthquakes coming, and they will continue to come. Hallelujah. But we need to point people to the person of Jesus Christ himself. Hallelujah. And there will be repentance, there will be revival, and there will be restoration of all things. If you believe it, you say amen. Amen and amen. Will you stand for a moment? I want to pray for you as I pray for myself. Glory to Jesus. So what's going to happen on April 8th? I don't know. Other than an eclipse is coming. But I guarantee this to you. Whatever happened, it has been written already. Nothing should surprise you. Hallelujah. It shall be well with me. Come on, will you declare that to you? It shall be well with me. It shall be well. I want to tell you this. The Holy Spirit right now is speaking to me, and he's saying, son, by your obedience of the message that you preach today, I am delivering somebody that lives in fear. Fear of destruction. Fear that something is going to come. Fear that they're going to be taking everything from them. Fear that their kids are going to be taken. Fear that they're going to lose everything that they have. And the Lord says, I'm going to set you free right in this moment. Hallelujah. As long as you put your eyes and faith in the person of Jesus Christ. Every eyes closed, I want to pray for you in this moment. Glory to Jesus in this moment. If you are that person, you're terrified about tomorrow. You are concerned of what is coming. You are concerned that you're going to lose all things. I want to speak a word to you right now, and I want you to hear me now. I'm speaking to you right in this moment. Jesus said to you, if a man loses his life for the sake of me, he will gain it back even more. He says, I have not seen a man that has lost everything that will not receive more in this age and in the age to come. The Lord is speaking to somebody, and he's setting you free from that fear that things will be destroyed, that fear that you're going to lose things in your life. The Lord wants to tell you, I preserve my people. to somebody, the Lord is telling you, I am doing a Goshen in your life, meaning when calamity comes, I make sure I protect you as my son and as my daughter. Hallelujah. Come on, if God is speaking to you, begin to be on receiving mode. That's when you say, God, it is I. Thank you for locating me. I receive right now, God, my deliverance, my miracle, because my faith is in Jesus alone. Father, I'm praying right now for your people. As I pray for myself, I know there's a lot happening in the world and around the world right now, God, but I pray that we will remain faithful to you. Let us not be deceived, neither let us be the instruments of deception, God. Never allow us to deceive your people by creating a fear so they can know you. No, God. Your word says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, God. Meaning that the fear that you speak about comes only when we know the Lord. Hallelujah. Not to get to know the Lord, but when we know the Lord. Hallelujah. This is when the reverence comes, God. And I pray in this generation, my generation, that as this generation is craving, is demanding for a sign, that we will say, no sign will be given to you but the sign of Jesus now, because Messiah Jesus, he died, was buried, and he rose again. Father, may you begin to minister now to your people in this hour. God, I pray that the great revival that you have in store, not only for this nation, for also around the world, God, will begin even now. But the hearts of men will come back to you. For this is revival, church. When the heart of men go back to God. When mankind returns to the Lord. When they repent of their sin. When they confess Christ as Lord and Savior. When salvation reaches their soul. When they are redeemed, restored by the grace, power of Jesus Christ. When their names are written in the book of life. When they are saving Jesus faithfully. When families are restored. When marriages are restored. When children grow knowing the Lord with such a hunger and thirst. Hallelujah. This is the sign of Jesus. This is the sign of true revival. When man returns to God, hallelujah, and for the right reasons, we come back to you because we love you. We come back to you because we know not only you are our creator, you are our father. We return to you because we know and understand that outside of you, we can do absolutely nothing. We return to you because we know that for us to be whole, to be complete, we need to be in a relationship with you. We come back to you because we know that the habitat of mankind is not the earth, but it is the presence of Almighty God. So we come back to you, and today we declare what your word says, God, that our eyes are set on the author and perfecter of our faith. Hallelujah. We shall not detour, God, but we shall keep our eyes on you always. God, we love you. God, we thank you. Thank you for your resurrection, and thank you because today you are not a sign, but you are a reality in our life. And we thank you for that in the name of Jesus. If you believe it, you say amen, amen, and amen. And give a mighty hand clap to the Lord. Glory to Jesus. He is the Lord. Hallelujah. And there is none greater than him. Hallelujah. There's no greater. No greater. No greater. Lift your hands to heaven, please. Lift your hands to heaven. If you're here today, that says the Lord to you. The Lord is saying, I'm crying now to this generation to return to me. I want you to hear what the Lord is saying to you. I'm crying out to a generation to return to me. I'm crying out to you, my church, to return to me. To put your eyes on me, says the Lord. I am the author and perfecter of your faith. Return to me. The Spirit of the Lord says, for many years the church have been wandering around, following different signs, but I tell you today, come back to me. 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 The Lord is calling you. Glory. The Lord is calling you to come, to return, to return. Come on, if you are here right now, if that is you, that you know that you need to return to God, here's what I want you to do. If that is you, lift your hands to heaven and say, God, I need to return to you. If you know that it is you, come. If that is you, I'm going to ask you to come forward. Come forward. If that is you, if you know that you need God, I'm asking you to come forward. I'm asking you to step out of your seat, and I want you to come forward. If you know, Orchard, please helping the people to come here. Hallelujah. If you know that you need Jesus, I want you to come forward. He's calling you right now. He's telling you, come. He's telling you, I'm calling you. I'm calling you. I'm calling you. I'm calling you. I want a relationship with you. I'm calling you. You cannot have a relationship with me outside. You cannot be in a relationship with me from a distance. You cannot know me from afar. You must be with me. The Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you. Anybody else? Anybody else who says, I need Jesus today? It doesn't get any better than this. He's calling you. Do not hide from me. 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 The Lord is telling you, do not hide. Come, 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 come. 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 He's calling you. Come on. The Lord is telling you, even the breath that you have belongs to me. Even the earth that you breathe belongs to me. Even the breath that you have belongs to me. It belongs to me. Everything comes from me. Nothing belongs to you. Nothing is yours. It is I that make you leave. I am. I am. I am the one who protects. I am the one that remains always with you. I am. I am. Let's search in your hearts. Search your heart today. Search your heart today. Search your heart today. Search your heart today. It is time to come to me. To return to me. It's time to seek my face. It is time. It is time, church. It is time, church. Church. Church, the Lord has spoken very clearly to you. He has spoken very clearly to you and to me right now. And the Lord has called you to come. Because the Lord says, I am coming, and I am coming, and I'm coming, and I'm coming, and I'm coming, and I'm coming soon. And I'm coming, coming soon. I want you to hear this, church. Thank you. The Lord is saying there is a decision that you need to make, and it has to be a decision from your heart. I am the Lord. Above me, there is no one. It is your decision. No one can make that decision. You and I, and nobody else. It's not with men. It is with me. It is with me. It is with me. Each one of you. I formed you. Amen. I'm going to ask the archers to come forward. Even if you're not serving today, I'm going to ask you to come forward. I want you to pray for these people. Those that serve in this house, I want you to come forward. I want you to pray for these people. Come, pray. Pray for the people. Pray for the people right now. Pray for the people. Pray for the people. Come forward and pray for the people. Those that serve in this house, come and pray for the people. We heard the word of the Lord. The Lord is calling you now. The Lord is telling you, come. The Lord is telling, give me your heart. It is your decision. Then come. Hallelujah. Come. 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 Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We are yielding to your calling today. We come back to you. Hallelujah. We come to you. We come to you right in this moment. Father, we come to you. We heard your voice. There's no greater sign than you, Lord. So we come back to you in this hour. We return to you because you alone are God. You call us to a serious decision today. You said it is you and I alone. You are calling us, God, in this hour. You are calling us in this hour. Father, we thank you. Because the fact that you rose from the dead tells us today that there is hope. So if you are calling us today, let us run to you in this hour. Father, we are responding to your calling. We are responding to your calling. We are responding to your calling, God. Never again. Never again. No turning back. No turning back. We are committing ourselves to you in this hour. We are committing ourselves to you. No turning back. No turning back. No. No. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back. Come home. 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 For I am the true vine, and you are the branches. Outside of me, you can do nothing. You can do absolutely nothing. But in me, you can do all things. Come. Come to me, and I shall restore all things in your life. Only come to me. Incense arise. Come on, give 1 minute of worship. Day and night, night and day. Just give him 1 minute of your worship.
Day and night, night and day. Let incense arise.
This is a place where you sealed a covenant with God. This is a place of freedom. Perhaps you're watching online in this hour, and the Lord tells you, I am the fountain of life. I am your redeemer. I am your savior. I am your everlasting help. And there is none besides me, says the Lord. He's God. Who is among you? Who is like you among the gods? And the answer is none is beside you, God. You stand alone in glory and in power. And today you called us home. for our eyes and our faith to be on you and never return. Never return to the world, but to remain in you. Father, we thank you for this great service that you are giving us. Thank you because your sign points to God. And this is the evidence of you pointing people to you. People coming back to you to tell you, we want a relationship with you. Father, we thank you. Father, we love you. Father, thank you for this moment that you have given us. Come on, will you lift your hands to heaven? I want to pray for you. May the Lord God bless you. May the Lord God keep you. May the Lord God make his face shine upon you. And may the Lord God give you peace. May he watch over your life as you exit and as you enter. And may the goodness of the Lord follow you all the days of your life. If you believe it, you say amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, people of God. May the Lord be with you. I hope and pray to see you next Sunday in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. And remember, you are the church. You already know Jesus. The sign is not for you. You are redeemed. In Jesus' name.
You deserve the glory.